microphone.
That could help. Voila. I'm surprised you don't have the little theme song yet.
A theme song?
Yeah.
Maybe today's the day.
Today's the day.
Something that you're gonna start singing.
I don't know. I think I would need to end my night with whiskey to write that song.
because it's my show.
No, just to write a little jingle. That's what I would need.
Alanna Shaladra.
That's me.
Okay, we're about to go live.
All right. He's here.
Woo-hoo.
Here he comes, Mr. Samuel. Sorry, I don't have a flag for you. Next time.
Next time.
Yeah.
We're live.
Oh my goodness.
And I can't remember. I think it will turn it. Interface here is like, I hope it's not like turning the wrong way, but if it is, it is.
Whatever. It'd be interesting. How are you? Sleepy?
Apparently.
I know, I got up early and I was like, gonna get ready in 5 minutes. And then you weren't there, so I could have just like, actually gotten ready, but I decided to stick with my 5 minute getting ready.
Yeah.
It's good. It's practice.
It is.
And then I watched videos of people auditioning for The Voice and cried for like 30 minutes, and now I'm here. It was great.
You
I was
cry
like,
for people auditioning
I was like,
people.
They're so happy. This is just beautiful. Their lives are going to be changed forever. I don't know if it's good, but they're happy right now.
All right, cameraman, come over here. This is your spot. This one, I think we're good. Just leave it, just like that.
Cool.
And and this is all going. So, yeah, maybe just watch and see if we get any comments that you can read. You can like put your hand up and if something interesting, not if it's like, you know, hi from whatever, but if they actually ask something like, where'd you get your hair done? Or something, and they want to know where I got my hair done.
Yeah.
And,
yeah, I know.
All right, here we are. It's been several weeks since we've had an episode, an official interview episode of the Mindful Activist webcast. My name is Matt Reddy. I am the host of this webcast, and I'm also an activist, an artist, author of the new book, Revolutionary Mindfulness, founder of the Global Consensus Project, and an elected politician. I'm a hospital commissioner for Jefferson County, Washington. And I am very happy to be here today with a young woman that I have known since she was a baby. at least that's the first time I saw her. Mm-hmm. But we've been sort of friends since she was 5 years old.
Yeah. We were roommates when I was five. We got a house together for a while.
We did. Everyone thought it was kind of weird, me and a five-year-old girl getting a house together.
Well, and my dad.
Oh, yeah, right.
Yeah.
So, Alanna Daly, amazing young woman, and singer, performer. What else are you?
I am a person. I don't know.
A person. Human being.
I guess so.
Excellent.
Water enthusiast.
Okay. You like water?
I do.
Without lots of flavor in it?
With no flavor, water. Just straight water, yeah.
Nice.
I don't really like chlorine in it either.
I hear you.
Yeah. I guess I'm really... Well, I'm passionate about music, and I'm also passionate about just like body image and self-esteem.
Interesting. So tell me more about that.
I don't know.
So
I should have prepared stuff to say.
Well,
I'm slow to respond.
That's okay. Someday we'll like edit the video down, so we'll cut out any
long
pauses.
Yeah, so then it'll look good.
Yeah.
So I'm not like
So do whatever you need to do in your process to think about your answer, and we'll pretend someday I'll edit these videos.
Perfect. Awesome. So when I'm in my 30s,
you'll
be like, hey.
You look.
I got you.
Yeah, you look great in this highly edited version of the interview.
Hi, my name.
So I assume you're talking about the way our culture views body
just
image.
The way that we view women's bodies and even men's bodies. Because I remember in kindergarten, I told my friend like, I like to puke. It makes me feel better. And then in high school, I was bulimic and anorexic, and I just had really poor image of my body. And then there's an organization made by a model named Katie Wilcox, and it's called Healthy as the New Skinny, and she came to Chimicum School when I was like 16 and did a talk about body image, and that really helped me start to pull myself out of my eating disorder and out of my deformed view of what I looked like. Because I had pretty severe body dysmorphia, which is when you see yourself as way bigger than you actually are. So when I see girls and women who clearly have an eating disorder, it's really hard for me to not just go up to them and be like, stop it, you're ruining your life. Don't do it, you're wasting your childhood.
Do you ever try that?
No, that doesn't work. I don't do it. I do it in my head.
Yeah.
But
do you like virtually do it? Like you imagine, I'm grabbing that woman.
I imagine myself doing that, but you have to actually be pretty, it's such a personal and sensitive subject. You have to know how to approach it based on the person.
Sure.
Yeah. And there's a lot of people, like some of my friends, I've said, like, I know you have an eating disorder. I know you have body dysmorphia. I can't tell you how to fix it, but I'm here for you. If you want to fix it, I can help you, but I'm not going to force you to. It's just like trying to get someone off of drugs. You can't force them to stop smoking cigarettes or stop doing meth. You can't stop people from their eating habits. But you can support them and help them be aware of it.
Well, you can if you can lock them in a room
and
control their movements.
Yeah, then they'll just completely be grateful for you doing that.
Yeah.
That's what people love.
Yeah, I mean, don't like...
I love when someone tries to completely control me by locking me in a cage and telling me, no, you're wrong.
I'm just saying, you were saying you can't do it, and I just wanted to point out, you can do it.
You can do it. If you want to maintain your positive relationship with that particular person.
It's called an intervention.
Yeah, but even with interventions, you have to be careful on how you approach it. So anything really sensitive and personal with someone, you have to be very careful with how you approach it. And that's hard.
Yeah.
Because when I was bulimic, my parents didn't really say anything to me, but my stepmom was printing out papers that that had facts about how bulimia can ruin your vocal cords. And then one of my friends pinned it on my door, so every morning when I woke up, that was what I would have to see when I was opening my door. And when you have a fact sheet with gross pictures on it, like, you kind of look at it.
That was very clever of them.
It was clever
of
them to
do that. It's like a subtle, subliminal...
So they didn't tell me to stop. They just said, like, here are some facts. I'm not even going to say anything. Like, boop, it's on your wall.
Now, did you at any point were you tempted to rip it down and throw it in the trash? Did you?
Yeah, but that... When I had that feeling, that made me realize, okay, I'm doing something harmful to myself. If this is offending me so much, then I must be guilty of doing it. I must feel bad about it.
So that was, that is the moment of, you know, that's like what was, sounds like your moment of truth.
Yeah.
It was like, you know, it's, and that's what you can't help another person get
no.
to their moment of truth. In a way, that was your rock bottom moment. It's like,
exactly.
Either I start denying the truth of what I'm doing to myself,
mm-hmm.
or I face it right now, and you've at that moment, or it, you were, you allowed yourself to stand in front of that fact
yeah.
until it was stronger than your craving
to harm myself.
To shape your body image.
Mm-hmm.
That's like a different, that's a two layers of things going on there. Your body image and your relationship to food.
Because
mm-hmm. Most people, they just have this relationship with food that they cannot control. You know,
well,
it's
a control issue with an eating disorder. Like, people develop it when they don't feel like they're in control of their lives. So that's why a lot of young girls do, because they feel pressured by media to look a certain way. They feel pressured at school to do all these things. They feel pressured by their parents to do all these things. You're growing up, your body's changing, your life is changing, you're supposed to be maturing. You don't understand things, you're starting to be interested in relationships, in boys or girls or sex or drugs, you're curious about everything, and it's just so much you get out of control. But the one thing you can control is how much or how little food that you eat.
Mm.
Because when you're really young, your parents pay attention to what you're eating because they're feeding you, but at a certain age, you take over and you're doing that yourself. So no one can control it for you.
And that transition from parental control of your food to you controlling your food, that can be kind of like a lot of friction between you and your parents.
Well, it's just like maturing, because
yeah.
I think it would be weird if I was 16 and my dad packed my lunch. I mean, it works for some people. I guess now I sometimes pack my dad's lunch, but...
Yeah. I find diet shaming very interesting.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, food shaming. You know, it's like, I mean, because everyone eats, and so everyone has an opinion about what foods are healthy,
mm-hmm.
and then lots of people have opinions about food in a moral sense, and they have lots of ethical... you know, moral judgments about it. And some people view health as the moral high ground of food
mm-hmm.
consumption. And so, and you know, particularly in this town where we live, there's a lot of eccentric and varied...
And lots of judgment regarding it.
Yeah. Yeah, how do you, how well do you, or how do you relate to it when someone's like, wrong. Whatever you're doing with that food right now is wrong, and they express that to you.
I don't think it bothers me that much.
No?
I don't really get that.
Do you get mockery for... I'm from the East Coast, and my family were like so good at mocking people. You know,
oh, really?
Not, yeah.
I can see that.
Yes.
I've known you for 15 years. I can...
Yeah, so I do have skill. I have a lot of skill in the mockery realm, but I've said...
I know that I have done it.
Yeah, mocking others.
Not really mocking others, but just being, like, kind of judgy about what they're consuming.
Mm-hmm.
And so then now I try to catch myself when I'm doing that. Because I don't want to be that kind of person. And it's really sad that, like, I'm really grateful that I can afford healthy foods. And I guess it's because I mooch off my parents and I don't pay any bills. That's why I can, if I had to pay bills, like, I only pay for my phone and I buy groceries. But if I had to pay for rent and pay for a car and all these things I'll hopefully have in the next few years, I won't be able to afford to eat like I do now. Or I'll have to really, really budget myself. I can still eat healthy, but I'll have a lot less options than what I do now. And I won't get to, like, go to Owl Sprint and get a smoothie all the time, or things, good things like that. But a lot of people don't even live near a place where they can get healthy foods like we do in Port Townsend. I can't imagine living somewhere that there's not fresh farms, organic farms nearby.
Yeah.
Like, how?
I can. That's where I grew up. You know,
I can't
East
imagine
Coast,
that.
Suburban,
like,
sprawl is what I grew up in. So
I go to the co-op and I'm like, oh, I'm looking for this specific farm because that's my friend's farm. I'm like, oh, this is Dharma Ridge? Yeah, I'm going to get Dharma Ridge. I lived at Dharma Ridge for 3 months with my mom and my aunt, and I've known those people for my whole life. I'm like, oh, Red Dog Farm? I've been there. Finn River Farm? I've been there. I'll get that. Like, I am so privileged to have that. And I'm so lucky and grateful that I grew up here and I have those connections.
Yeah, it's a pretty amazing place.
Mm-hmm. I don't want to live here forever and ever, but it's good. And it was so nice. I lived in France last year, and they have market on Wednesday and Saturdays, like we do, the farmer's market uptown, and it's huge.
How big of a town were you in?
Where the market was, it's like 50,000 people, I think. It's called Bourgogne Place, which is where my boyfriend lives. And I love that market. I was like, let's stay here all day. Just buy produce. And they actually had live chickens. People would, like, it made me sad, but also part of me is like, this is awesome that there's live chickens for people to buy for food. And then the other part of me is like, this is really horrible. I don't want to see a live chicken and know that it knows it's going to be food.
You think the chicken knows it's going to be food?
It's just scared. I think it doesn't know what's going on.
Yeah.
So, like,
that's the way we all feel all the time.
Yeah.
Scared.
What's
we don't know
going on?
Like chickens in little chicken cages at the market in France.
Yeah, basically. Yeah. But I guess how I contribute is I don't eat very much meat.
Well, let me ask you the question that I ask everyone.
Okay.
Do you consider yourself an activist?
No. I consider myself starting to be interested in it, but I don't feel like I'm an activist right now. I don't think that I don't put too much focus or my time or my energy onto a lot of things that are going on.
Mm-hmm.
I try to stay notified and a bit updated, but I don't feel like an activist.
How do you feel about the like this, the way our country works, the way our government works. I mean, do you basically feel like it's pretty good or so-so
no.
or where would you?
I don't understand a lot of it, and the parts that I do understand just seem really shitty.
Like what?
And just, it's like a group of people that are voting based off of what benefits them. So there's a top, very small percentage picking for everybody. And it's people who have never been in poverty. It's a bunch of privileged men, and I'm sure there's some women in there too. A bunch of privileged people choosing rules and regulations for people they don't relate to in any way.
Kind of messed up.
It's really messed up. Like, if you haven't experienced like poverty or discrimination or all these other bad things, you can't relate to it. You don't know how it feels.
Why would they want to know how that feels?
Well, no one should know how it feels, but it's just really sad. Like, all the things with Planned Parenthood, why are they picking on Planned Parenthood? Especially if Planned Parenthood isn't even government funded. Like, it's just a distraction.
Yeah, I think the distraction's a lot of how the people in power keep power.
It's true. It's about fear. How they keep power is, it's just fear. Like, oh, the Mexicans are all rapists. They're stealing your jobs and they're rapists. Like, okay, a lot of Mexican immigrants are coming to USA and doing jobs that Americans think they're too privileged and too good for. That's not stealing our jobs. And also, people aren't coming here just to rape Americans. Like, that makes it sound like, oh, I'm so great that everyone from another country poorer than my country wants to rape me. Like, that sounds pretty privileged and stupid. And just like, all Muslims are terrorists. If you think all Muslims are terrorists, you've never met a Muslim person. Like, I've met a lot of Muslim people, and I did not feel they were terrorists. And also, not all Muslim people look the same. It's just, there's so much generalization about people, and it's just to keep us afraid. And keep the hate going.
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of the debates that they get us, every presidential election they get us arguing about, are just sort of like very convenient, closed debates. Both answers are good for the people in power.
Yeah.
So it's just like, you know, it's like, that's why I was drawn to activism, like Occupy Wall Street, because they were going out in the streets and saying, changing the subject, saying, the problem is, the 1% is controlling the entire government.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what you just said,
yeah.
It was like, you know, you have to be an activist to change the topic, because
mm-hmm.
you have to say wrong topic, wrong question.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, in theory, good journalists, maybe bloggers could do that, you know, help
mm-hmm.
change it. But if the big media outlets are controlled by the people with all the money that are also trying to choose the topics, hard to change topics on the big media channels.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we could go two directions with the next question.
Okay.
We could go towards speaking spirituality and science fiction-ish things, or we could go towards Donald Trump.
I'm too tired for Donald Trump. Like.
That's good. So we'll go. You want
Donald Trump. I'm glad that you have a healthy family and you're able to take care of them, and your children are able to pursue their lives and their dreams. Because his children seem like genuinely happy people. So
Wow. That's
good. A lot of people are not genuinely happy.
Was very nice of you to say.
So, I didn't say anything about him. I just mean his kids.
Still, wishing well wishes to a person's family is generally considered a nice gesture.
Well, I think he could have had some good ideas in there, but.
Don't think he has any good ideas?
I'm sure he does, but it's hard for me to actually listen for very long.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, when it's in his head, it might have been a good idea. Just when he speaks, it just.
Yeah.
So spirituality. That's what I can focus on without getting too weird.
Okay. Alright, so we'll shift away from Donald Trump.
Yeah.
All right,
no one wants to talk about him. I mean, they do, but.
It's kind of a love-hate relationship with the topic every human being has right now. It's like, sick of it, yet it's also really...
It's really relevant.
Relevant, and there's so much there to talk about.
Definitely.
You can just... It's like so many layers of bizarre, surreal reality.
Yep.
Okay, but we'll go to a different part of surreal reality.
Yeah, we'll go to the more fun part.
Okay, here we go. So, do you believe that there is anyone else listening to this conversation that you and I are having?
Sam is.
Okay.
Actually, I don't know if he's listening. He just shook his head. He's not listening.
Okay.
Head's just like, doo-doo-doo-doo.
Besides Sam, do you believe there's anyone else listening to this conversation in the entire universe?
In the entire universe? I'm gonna guess there's like two people on Facebook Live, and then I'm sure the government has something bugged in here, so maybe that's about 20 people. And
okay,
but no.
Anyone else? Anything else beyond that? Any other anything like ghosts? Or aliens.
Oh, there could be ghosts.
There could be ghosts?
Yeah.
So that's a possibility?
Especially in this town.
More ghosts in this town than in other places? Or more ghosts out in the open?
I think they're just more free and open here.
Because
this was a town for like sailors and prostitutes. So I think they're just all over the place. They're just doing their thing.
It's like, why would they leave Port Townsend? You know?
They can't.
Do you think there's any in this room right now? Sailors and prostitute ghosts?
I think they're mostly downtown.
Downtown?
Yeah.
And they might not be up this time of day.
Yeah,
you know,
they're sleeping.
Sleeping until 3 in the afternoon, maybe.
Yeah, that's what I would be doing, too.
Yeah. Okay. So seriously, are you open to the possibility that ghosts are real?
Yes.
Okay. Anything
I don't
else?
Think they look like Casper the Friendly Ghost, but
no.
I've felt something that the definition of a ghost would explain.
And do you do you feel like if I believed in ghosts, if I believed they were real, I would just assume 24 hours a day one was watching me.
Yeah.
I mean, is that the way you live, or do you feel like they're real, but I'm pretty sure they leave me alone. They're not watching me 24 hours a day like you know every human would if they could watch other humans.
I feel like they are at my work.
but not at home.
Yeah, my house doesn't feel creepy. But at work.
But is that just you psychologically not letting yourself think about ghosts watching you in your home? Because
I think
really,
so.
You know?
Well, now I'm going to think about it.
Yeah. That's why I find this question interesting. Because it's like, it doesn't really matter if your answer was ghosts or God or aliens or whatever.
I do believe in ghosts, but I don't constantly think about how I believe in them. And I don't constantly think about... I guess I believe that it's possible.
Do you ever talk to ghosts?
I kind of did when I was little, but I don't know if it's ghost or imaginary friends.
Hmm. Okay. So we've got the idea of these invisible beings, ghosts, but they're not terribly interested in your life.
No.
It sounds like you think they might be there, but they are not like sitting here like right here, like with their head like staring at you.
No, I don't think I do enough interesting things.
Okay. Have you ever seen Big Brother, you know, that TV show? They just set up cameras inside this house of people and nothing really interesting happens except millions of people watch it because they can.
No, I haven't.
No. Anyways.
I don't watch shows like that because they're not interesting.
But millions of people do.
Yeah, welcome to...
I'm just saying, if there's ghosts, then there's millions of them. And some of them would
so,
find you
so
fascinating.
So we actually have a whole audience.
We would have...
True. Actually, if there's millions and millions of ghosts, there's at least one that finds me fascinating.
Actually, there's probably at least a few thousand that find
oh,
you fascinating.
There we go. So... I already have a very successful music career from that.
Yeah, and I have a very successful webcast.
Here we go.
Tons of
go
people.
Us.
Yes. We are popular in the ghost realm.
Yeah.
If there is a ghost realm. So is there anything we want to say to the ghost realm audience? You know, or...
Hi.
You're looking at the
Thanks
camera.
For watching.
You're assuming a lot
they,
of them
they
are getting
watch,
the camera feed.
They're watching somebody else who's watching
yeah.
the show.
Well, that's the power of... including other people at all, is all the ghosts that are watching them
yeah.
are now, in effect, also watching us, so it amplifies.
There we go. Could be.
Okay. All right, I haven't talked to anyone about that, the whole ghost thing, but let's like leave the ghosts. Besides ghosts and the humans on Facebook Live and Sam, who's barely paying attention over there.
Thanks, Sam.
You're doing great. Do you believe anything else is listening to this conversation? Like, anything?
No.
And are you absolutely sure of that? Or are you just like...
No.
Are you like, it just doesn't like interest you to think about it?
Why? Like, my dad's family is Southern Baptist, and then I've had friends who are, like, Jehovah's Witness and Mormon, and so I've, like, heard about the Bible a lot, I've read pieces of it, and I don't believe in God like that. I don't think that there's one guy watching over every single person that ever existed and, like, judging.
Do you think there's one guy just sort of casually observing and not judging?
No.
Or maybe, like, 12? Like, Zeus and Athena and Artemis? Maybe they're all, like, sitting
down
at the table.
That's way more fun. I don't believe in anything, but I also, I'll never say that there's not anything.
But again, it's not one of those things that you think is so possible that you'd really, that you ever like actually think it's true. Like,
I don't.
Like, you do sometimes think the ghost thing is true, but you don't really, you don't think about the,
Well, I think
super
about
ghosts. I mean, just think, gods are basically just super ghosts. Yeah,
well,
you don't think about super ghosts?
Kind of. Like, I think about ghosts because it's fun to be like, ooh, it's a spooky building and it's haunted and there's ghosts and they're gonna get you. And then go to a haunted house or this haunted
Yeah.
mansion. Like,
So it's fun.
it's fun. Yeah. And there could be super ghosts. I just don't base my choices off of that, I guess.
Well, what if there's super ghosts? We'll just go with super ghosts. We won't use the word God.
Yeah.
Super ghosts, and they're super because they can like somehow do stuff that interacts with our world. Where were they going with this?
I don't know. We'll see.
What if they are just not? I mean, some people believe in their God or religion or whatever because they, at some point, someone convinces them to just try it. Try praying, try talking to it and see if the super ghosts or whatever gods, see if your life changes. And then sometimes
It
people
works.
seems it seems to work. So maybe that's what it is. Maybe you just need to try asking the super ghosts to do something.
But I see at people asking their version of super ghost, like for stuff.
Sounds like you're judging what they're asking
Well, like,
for.
if you're not supposed to ask for stuff, apparently. I
How do you
mean,
know that? Who told you? Did a super ghost
the
tell you
Bible,
that?
my preacher great
Said,
grandfather.
don't ask for stuff.
Like, I'm pretty sure, like, if you're gonna ask a super ghost, like, don't ask for stuff.
What should you
Like,
ask
if
for?
you, like, you could start asking for. I don't know, just. I don't know, that's really hard. It's just really weird to me when I see people just on Facebook that are like, please pray for me and for so I can get this thing, this material thing. But it doesn't bother me when people are like, please pray for me, like, I am in the hospital. Like, pray for my health. Pray for my mental stability. Pray for my ability to focus. That makes sense to me. Because I really feel like the magic, I feel like we all have it. We all have a piece of it. And we, I think when someone's praying to God, you're really looking inside yourself for an answer. Like, my mom always tells me, like, you know the answer. Like, you know inside of yourself what the answer is and what you think is right. So some people need an outside source to do that. Some people need a second opinion.
Are you
And
saying God is a second opinion?
I think God is a second opinion, 'cause you're praying, you're looking up to God for that second opinion,
But
but
unless
I think
God
it's
is.
really,
Okay.
but I think what you're really doing, my perspective of it is when you're like looking up praying to God or looking down praying to God, whichever way you look, like you're opening up yourself, you're allowing yourself to be vulnerable because you have created God in your life as someone you can be vulnerable to. And a lot of people don't allow themselves to be vulnerable to themselves or to their friends or their family. But God is a safe person that you can talk to. And so I think that's why people pray.
Yeah, that's really interesting because I grew up Catholic and taught to pray from an early age. And I was like, all right, I'll try this. I didn't like listen to anyone when they told me what to pray for or to use like standard written prayers. I was like, okay, I'm gonna believe you that there's some God and I'm gonna talk to him, but I'm gonna talk to this God however I feel like I should. You know, I was like, and I did. I prayed. Pretty much every night until I was in college, and it was incredibly psychologically useful.
Yeah.
It was massive. I mean, it was like, I mean, what can be more empowering, especially at that age, you know, as, you know, being a teenager and growing from a child, to believe you can talk to God.
Mm-hmm.
It is so, really helped me, you know, with like, I was like very scared at night and when I was really young, like,
mm-hmm.
of the dark.
Mm-hmm.
Vampires and
yeah.
stuff and
all those creepy things, ghosts.
Yeah, and so when I was taught praying, you know, in Catholicism, it's you make the sign of the cross on you, and that's how you start a prayer. And so if I got scared a bit, I would just let them do that.
Yeah,
and it was, and I would do like that, and I was like, I'm with God now. You can't, you can't get me. I'm on, you know.
See, it's a safety net,
yeah.
which I think that's really beautiful, and it's really helpful to people, because I know people who have converted to a religion when they're older, and that's really helped them get through things in their life, and it's helped them become a better person in their own eyes and in other people's eyes too. I think that's wonderful.
Yeah, I mean, I think it, if we just stopped at that, everyone talked to God, just said that, if that was all that people did, but then you have people that say, I talked to God and I know what he said you
and he told
do.
Me to go shoot all these people.
Or just to go tell you to tell to what to do. What
yeah.
you should eat, where you should do this, you know, and it's like, I mean, that's the whole...
That's my problem with organized religion, is I think that most of the people are good. But then there's some extremists. And so that's where it's hard for me to really want to be a part of a religion. Because people are like, you have to think like this, you have to do this, and this, and this, and this. This is how it is.
Yeah, I mean, I think the problem comes in once you start saying certain people know God better than others.
Yeah,
and they
that's
have authority
the
of God. I mean, that's a, I mean, how much more authority can you have, in how much more power can you have in the world than for one of us to sit here and say, we are equal human beings, except I talk to God.
Yeah.
God tells me what to tell you.
Like, you were raised Catholic, I was raised atheist. Like, oh, I'm superior to you because I was raised Catholic. I've known God since I was born. It's just, I feel like if you believe in God and if he's really there, and people always say, only God can judge me. But then they're judging each other. And they're like, oh, this form of Christianity is superior. No, I'm superior. No, I'm superior.
It kind of goes back to what we were talking about at the beginning, about how gentle you have to be when you're... you want to, yeah, about something deeply
yeah.
personal that
exactly.
is like inside. It's the same
and
thing with like.
It's religion.
It's, yeah, it's basically that intimate. I mean, there's nothing more intimate than thinking you're talking to God in your head.
Exactly.
And so, if you're going to tell someone what,
if you're going to tell someone what to think, or if you think they're wrong, like
at one of the most basic levels of existence, you're going to tell them.
Yeah.
That is such a presumptuous thing for me. For anyone to tell another person, like, you should feel this, or what you're feeling is wrong.
You can't
or
tell people how to feel.
I mean, you can, but...
You can. Okay,
again,
let me
don't
rephrase.
Limit what
you
response...
You shouldn't. Oh, you're so literal. You should not tell people how to feel.
I think it's just a waste of energy.
I think it's okay to express how you feel, but you can't... Okay. Here's what you can't do. You can't expect people to react the same way that you react and to feel the same way that you feel. You can't force it and you can't expect it.
I go a step before that and I say, you can't expect a person to want to hear whatever you want to say.
Oh yeah, that's true too. That's definitely true.
Yeah. So it's like, I mean, I think it's like, if more of us were just like, before I shoved my words over you, maybe I'd just check to see, can I say something to you
yeah.
about this topic?
I actually, one of my friends, I was talking to her I was ranting to her about something, and she said, before you talk, do you want me to listen, or do you want me to give my opinion?
And that's beautiful.
And I was like, that is the most beautiful thing anyone's ever said to me. And I said, actually, I do want your opinion. I do want your advice. And so then I told her what I needed to say, and then she gave me advice. And she's the person that she gives you advice, but she doesn't expect you. She's not going to be offended if you don't do what she said. And I think that's something that everybody needs to learn how to do. We should be taught from a young age, like at school, if someone's talking, like, are we listening to listen for that other person, or are we listening to just give an opinion? And so I know that I catch myself all the time just like giving my opinion. That's so easy to do. You're like, oh, you're talking to me. Let me tell you how to feel. And then I have to stop myself and step back and be like, if I already said it, then I'm like, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said anything. But that's something that all humans need to figure out how to do.
Yeah.
It's definitely a learning process. It's difficult, especially if it's someone you care about and you want to help. That's a problem I think that parents have. Is parents don't want to see their kids feeling bad or struggling or whatever sort form of negative emotion, so then they try to control it.
Yeah. Yeah, it seems, I think of it as like safety, you know, it's just like, it's just the more aware you are of what you can do to make someone feel safer when you're talking with them, and the more aware you are of the things you do that are actually attacks, a little like, it's like, if you just learn.
Do this, come on.
Yes.
If you do this, you'll be happier.
Yeah. But that's stupid.
You're going to be so fucking zen if you do this.
Don't
come on.
That's ridiculous.
Matt, listen to me.
You're such a child. Yeah. I mean, but people do that, like, so often. I mean,
yeah.
It's, like, amazing. And
we don't even notice
it's
it.
It's, like, jabs, you know? And, yeah. It's fascinating. It's a fascinating thing, human relationships.
Yeah. Relationships are confusing.
And we don't learn it, and then our politicians don't learn it, and then, you know, they bicker in public, and the political activists, they do kindergarten level, like, communication techniques.
Maybe if you're a politician, you need to go back to kindergarten.
And just learn how to, you know,
how to be a decent person.
Well, there's a book called Everything I Ever Needed to Know I Learned in Kindergarten.
Yeah.
And it's like, it has the 8 rules, and it's basically like, you know, be nice to each other, pick up after yourself. You know, it's like,
wait,
you know, share.
Turn.
Share. So it's like, what if we shared the resources of the world, and when a corporation or somebody built something and made a big mess, they cleaned it up.
What if everybody worked together so that we can get things done?
Maybe we just make like those kindergarten rules, this giant billboard, you know, like
maybe
the size of
that's what. Maybe that's what my sign will be for the Women's March on Saturday.
That'd be awesome. So you're going to the Women's March?
Yeah, hopefully.
That's kind of an activist-ish thing to do, you know.
Well, I told you I'm starting.
Yeah.
Just starting.
That's cool.
And I, the hesitation with the Women's March is, like, people being like, fuck Trump, not my president, blah, blah, blah. And I'm really hoping that it's more focused on the energy of everyone who has been discriminated against, like, we're here to march for you and show you our support. So I really hope that it's not more towards, like, a fuck you Trump march. I want it as support the people who need it. March.
Yeah.
I don't know what it'll turn out to be.
Well, you bring whatever energy that you bring to it.
Yeah. Well, I know. I was reading on the Facebook page, like, for the people who originally set it up, and I think the original idea for it is support women, support people of color, and support the LGBTQ plus queer community, and just support the people that are really being targeted.
Yeah.
And just say, we are here, we are together. And I just want it to have that sort of energy.
That's great. Yeah, and I just food for thought, because I've been in a lot of marches.
Yeah.
And occasionally some group starts to chant something that you don't want to chant.
Yeah.
And you know, there's nothing stopping you from like I was at
you
one.
You can start chanting something else.
Yeah, or you can change a word. Like
yeah.
You know, I've been in a where you know some group starts to say something really hostile to the police or something, and another group they had some phrasing that stuck right over their chant that is a little that was friendlier and
yeah.
whatever, and they just started a group just doing that. So you can have these little like chant offs.
Yeah, chant offs.
Yes.
And then we'll have a little dance off.
That's right. All right.
Good.
Awesome. That reminds me, there is we have to do some dancing, like, right here, like,
well,
because...
From September, Earth, Wind, and Fire, like, that's our jam.
That is. You remember, like, us
yeah.
singing and dancing?
Of course I do. That was my life.
Ah, the 70s music that I exposed
and
you
now
to
we'll,
from a young age.
We'll cut it to the video of you, me, and my dad dancing.
I wonder if we still have that.
I'm sure you do somewhere.
Yeah. But I like to like have, we don't have the copyright to Earth, Wind, and Fire, you know, so we'll like stick some YouTube free, you know,
well,
music.
I've got a brand new pair of roller skates, you got a brand new key. I think we should get together and try them on to see.
Nice. Keep going.
I can see it.
Good. All right. So good. We got a little bit of dancing. Now I'm gonna tell you something that
okay.
I think I went on Facebook and I said a week ago. You'll never guess what I just did. And
oh yeah.
Nobody guessed it.
Yeah.
But I'm gonna tell you because you are of all the people I know, you might appreciate it the most.
Okay. I'm honored.
So, I was recorded singing on for a song for this Women's March.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, with Judah Kate?
Yeah.
I was invited to do that, but I...
You could have been recorded with me.
I could have. Oh, well, I'll be singing the song.
Awesome.
Maybe
yeah.
I'll be in the, like, the Christmas jingle version next next year.
That would have been so incredible if you and I...
extra festive version.
That would have been so cool if I'd walked in there and, you know...
Yeah, I would have been like, sit down, all right, you're on that mic, all right, here's headphone two, let's go.
Actually, it was more like, I was the only one other guy that got invited,
mm-hmm.
and it wasn't because of my singing voice, I just said, you know, I just offered to.
Yeah.
I was like, if you want male voices, I've come, whatever, and...
I know, I wish I could have gone to that.
Yeah.
But it was my first day of therapy, so I was like, I should probably go to my first day of therapy.
You're so transparent, you know, it's very,
yeah.
very endearing. It makes people really trust you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I know. My great-grandfather's 90th birthday was on the 14th, and on breakfast before my parents and I left, my granddad goes to my dad, you know, son, I'm just really happy that no one in my family, we ain't got nothing to hide. I was like, yep, this family, we are all completely ourselves.
Yeah.
I was like, you have a family of shameless people. That is true, Granddad.
It is.
Especially my dad and me.
Yeah, it's one of the reasons I've been friends with your dad and a part of your life since you were...
Yeah.
5 years old like that. Because
you need to be transparent.
Yeah, I mean, people that don't have shame and don't get embarrassed if they say something stupid will just say whatever they actually feel.
I mean, I get embarrassed.
But it doesn't hold
I'm
you
not,
back.
I'm not quite at my dad's level of shame.
Ramon, but
no. I get embarrassed, but I like still continue.
But it makes you very brave. Very brave, and you're willing to take risks, you know, with whatever you do or say. And
yeah, well, it's, everyone makes mistakes. Everyone gets uncomfortable, so that's not a reason to stop.
Yeah, pain is not a reason to stop.
Well, I mean, if you're, like, bleeding out, then you should.
Right. I'm just saying, that's, like, injury.
Yeah.
Injury, trauma is a reason to stop, but pain is not, you know? Yeah. Awesome. Well, is there anything, we can, like, wrap up there? Do you want to say anything else, or do you want to, like, just, like, sing a song to close, or what do you want to do?
Well, I guess I'd say that I had an album planned that didn't work out. There was a bunch of drama and fun stuff that happened. And then I recorded my album in town, and then I had to take a break from my life. So I moved to France for a year and took a break from my life. And I've been back home since end of August. And last night, I sent my recordings to a CD printing company, and today I'm gonna pay for it once they confirm they have everything. And so, a bunch of shitty things happened, partially my fault, partially other people's fault, but I still did it. So I'm really proud of myself for still getting it done.
That is so awesome.
Yes.
And that's how I feel about my book, you know, it's like, not that I had the same drama craziness you went through, but it's like, you know, once you accomplish something like that, and you've done it, and you've produced it, I feel like it creates this like, oh, I could do this again.
Yeah.
I can like do another one.
During the process, I was like, I don't think I can do music anymore, like this has just been too much for me, and then they sent my... I sent the music to the printer, and I was like, oh, that was great. This has been a great 3 years.
Yeah, well, you went through the pain. You were like, just pushed yourself through the pain of the creation process.
And I'm lucky to have so many good people in my life to allow me to feel my pain. Like, I was able to just, for some people, I had to be like, don't tell me not to be sad. Let me wallow in my self-pity for a while, and then I'll continue on.
Yeah.
Let me be sad. Let me be angry. And it might be a couple weeks, might be a few months, and then I'll do something else. I'll focus my energy somewhere else. And so I'm excited. I'll probably have my CDs in a couple weeks, and I'll bring you one.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Well, you can have one of my books if you want.
Okay.
Yeah. You can leave here with it.
Awesome.
Yeah, so you can just take that top one right there.
Right here?
Yeah.
You'll need to sign it.
Sure.
Cool.
What does the album have a title?
It's called Little Dreams.
Little
Dreams.
Little Dreams.
Mm-hmm.
And do you want to like just like give a little sample of anything just like right now? Just share.
Sure. Let's see. Whew. I'll sing you the song I was most uncomfortable to record, because I usually sing jazz and blues, and this is not either of those. And also, it turned out to be my favorite on the album because I did a bunch of harmonies. Fare ye well, my honey. Fare ye well, my only true friend. All the birds that were singing I've flown except you alone. Gonna leave this broke down palace on my hands and my knees. I will row, row, row. I don't remember the words very well, but yeah.
That is awesome.
It's fun to harmonize with yourself because it has the same resonance. So you're like, wow, I sound really good with myself. You can have a beautiful egotistical moment with yourself.
But yeah, I mean, well, that's, I mean, that's just the way I sort of feel anytime I'm looking at like my creations, like my book. It's like I read it and like, whoa, I get to really enjoy it. I said that.
Yeah.
You know, it's like.
Well, then really, you get new perspective of it when you.
Yeah. And I'm like,
looking
whoa.
At your own creations.
Yeah, because it has layers of meaning I didn't even think I thought of when I wrote it or
yeah.
did it.
I got to visit my elementary school last week and I sang for the whole school. It's like 30, 40 kids.
Yeah.
And there was one little girl that was just looking up at me like I was so, so amazing. And it's like, that's why I sing. When I was in choir, I had so many parents come up to me and say, my daughter started choir or my son started choir because they heard you sing. And they saw you in choir. So I guess I want to leave this on. Don't be scared to create things because it can help inspire kids to do it.
Very nice.
Yes.
All right. Well, thank you so much
for
being a guest. This has been so fun. Do we have any like comments out there that are worth
Nobody's talking
addressing?
To us.
No? Okay. All right. Well, that's all. Maybe I'll just say next month, I think February 16th or something. It's like the third Thursday of the month. I'm hosting a online general assembly using the HiveOne .NET software that I developed, part of the Global Consensus Project. So this will be an interesting experiment, inviting people anywhere and everywhere to join in on a conversation like this. We'll just sort of like expand out to thousands of people.
Perfect.
Yeah. So I think that's all. Until next time, thank you, anyone that
thank
watches.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Dun, dun. All right, that one is down.